Marvelous. Welcome to Trinity Lutheran Church in the middle of beautiful downtown Brattleboro, Vermont. We're in the Easter season, and our theme in the Easter season is going to be third day living. We want to live in the day of the resurrection, the day of new life. This morning, a special welcome to Pastor Richard Olson, who used to lead worship here. Richard, raise your hands so everybody can see you. Great to see you. And Richard comes to us from Gardner, Massachusetts, so it's great to have you here. And welcome back to Diane. Diane Hill is here from Florida. And how long will you be here, Diane?
Till November.
Till November. So it's great to see Diane. And when is Lynn coming back, Laura?
May 2nd.
So she'll be back in 2 weeks. That's great. A couple of announcements. One really significant announcement this morning, and that is that Anna Anderson from our church is home. She has COVID. She was diagnosed last week. She's on special meds that she thinks are helping her. So we want to remember Anne in our prayers. I think she's diabetic, right?
Yes.
I think she's asthmatic, too. So that's kind of a serious situation. So we want to remember Anne in our prayers. And if folks want to give her a call or something, that'd be terrific. I'm sure she'd appreciate that. Having said these things, we gather to give thanks to God. And we gather because we know the teaching of Jesus is a light for our path. So we seek to give praise to God, to give thanks to God, and we seek to gain direction from the teaching of Jesus. And we also recognize that it's hard to follow the way of Jesus, that there are all kinds of temptations that we have, and that some of our instincts are to do things our own way, on our terms, and not necessarily to follow God's call. So we begin our worship with a prayer of confession. Which is really our acknowledgement that we have struggles, and it's our call to God to be our help. During our confession, there will be time for silence. I encourage you to focus on the breath, releasing the tensions of life, and receiving a new breath of peace from God. Let us pray. Merciful Lord, we confess that we spend too many moments of our lives complaining, finding fault in others, wishing life was more and better. We are not grateful for the blessings that are. We become captive to our own interests and desires. We get selfish. We sin in our thoughts, words, and desires by what we do and by what we do not do. Have mercy on us. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, lead us out of the world of crucify and into the world of the resurrection and new possibility. O Lord, may we, through the presence of our Lord Jesus Christ, be people of the third day. Amen. The word of God to us, the word of Jesus, is a word that we are loved by God, that we are accepted, that the power of the Holy Spirit, the power of the risen Christ is with each of us. It is one of my privileges to proclaim the entire forgiveness of all of our sins. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
I invite you to stand for our opening hymn, Thine is the Glory. Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. God. Amen. feast and celebration, all of creation sings for joy. The God of life and love and freedom, praise and glory forevermore. Now is the feast of the Lamb once slain, whose blood has freed and united us to be one great people of God. Now the feast and celebration, all of creation sings for joy. The God of life and love and freedom, praise and glory forevermore. Power and riches, wisdom and might, all honor and glory to Christ forever. Now the feast and celebration, all of creation sings for joy. To the God of life and love and freedom, praise and glory forevermore. For God has come to dwell with us, to make us people of God, to make all things new. Praise and glory forevermore.
Let us pray together. O Lord, lead us into the third day. In times of doubt, may we have the courage to trust in you. In times of darkness, may we be inspired to walk in your light. May we live into the mystery of the new life you present us through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated.
The reading is from 1 Corinthians, the 15th chapter. Now, brothers and sisters, I want to remind you of the gospel I preached to you, which you received and on which you have taken your stand. By this gospel you are saved, if you hold firmly to the word I preached to you. Otherwise, you have believed in vain. For what I received, I passed on to you as of first importance, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas and then to the 12. After that, he appeared to more than 500 of the brothers and sisters at the same time, most of whom are still living, though some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles, and last of all he appeared to me also, as to one abnormally born. For I am the least of the apostles, and do not even deserve to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God I am what I am, and his grace to me was not without effect. No, I worked harder than all of them. Not yet I, but the grace of God that was with me. Here ends the reading.
Thanks be to God.
We'll take turns reading responsibly Psalm 150. Praise God. Praise God in God's sanctuary. Praise God in God's mighty heavens.
Praise God for God's acts of power. Praise God for God's surpassing greatness.
Praise God with the sounding of the trumpet. Praise God with the harp and lyre.
Praise God with timbrel and dancing. Praise God with the strings and flute.
Praise God with the clash of cymbals. Praise God with resounding cymbals.
Let everything that has breath praise the Lord.
The gospel reading is from the Gospel of John at the 20th chapter. Glory
to you, O Lord.
On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the religious leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As God has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit." Now one of the 12 was not with the disciples when Jesus came, Thomas. So the other disciples told Thomas, "We have seen the Lord." But Thomas said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again. Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them. And Jesus said, "Peace be with you." And Jesus said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told Thomas, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
May be seated. Grace and peace be unto you from God, our Creator, and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus. May the church say amen.
Amen.
I'm going to do something really different this morning, and this is going to be kind of an intellectual thing to a certain extent. And what I'm going to expose you all to is some really recent study and some recent scholarship. And so recent that I bet Richard never went through this when he was in seminary. I certainly didn't learn this in seminary. So this is going to be new for Richard. Talk to him afterwards. And I can assure you that this didn't really come out until probably the year 2005. So this is new stuff. And I think it's fascinating. So let's go backwards a little bit. In the early history of the church, you know, when these disciples had heard about Jesus, there were no printing presses. Nothing was written down. There was no Bible. Stories were passed. Sue would tell me a story about Jesus. I would tell Chris a story about Jesus. Stories were passed in what's called oral tradition, and they were passed from groups of people to groups of people. In fact, the first written account about the resurrection is what Beverly read in Paul's letter to the Corinthians. That's the first writing about the resurrection. It comes from Paul. Because what Paul did was Paul went from community to community, and he started groups of people who would be followers of Jesus, and then afterwards he would write them a letter. And those are the first writings that we have. So in the early history of the church, you have to think about this, for the first couple hundred years, all they had were maybe Paul's letters to various communities. There was no gospel story about Jesus. And the thought is, there was no gospel, there's no story about Jesus that was written, because people expected him to return. And then when he didn't return right away, some of the writers decided, you know, we better write this stuff down about the story of Jesus. So that is what they did. Mark, Matthew, Luke, They wrote their accounts of Jesus, and those were the first accounts about Jesus, the first stories of Jesus. And they were written probably about 30 to 60 years after Jesus rose from the dead. So for 30 to 60 years, the stories passed from one group to another, or what's called oral tradition, until finally some of this was written down. Now, in the early history of the church, there was this one disciple, and he was the focus of this reading this morning. His name was Thomas. Thomas. In the early part of the church, there were what are called Thomas Christians. These are people who gravitated to Thomas's account of Jesus. Thomas wrote what is called the Gospel of Thomas. Has anyone ever heard of the Gospel of Thomas? So we have Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, and then there's the Gospel of Thomas. The Gospel of Thomas wasn't discovered until 1940s. But in the early part of the church, they had the Gospel of Thomas. And the Gospel of Thomas is not a narrative. What it is a listing of the teachings of Jesus. It's basically a series of quotations from Jesus. And one of the things that Thomas wrote about Jesus, Thomas said that Jesus said this. Jesus said that if you want to find the holy, look within yourself. Now that's not antithetical to basic Christian teaching, because we say that we receive the holy where? That we receive the presence of Christ that is within us in. Paul wrote that if you say that you have faith, you do so by the power of the Holy Spirit, which is within you. Paul wrote the body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. So what is within us? The Holy Spirit. So Thomas quotes Jesus as saying, if you want to find the holy, look within yourself. And so the Thomas Christians did that, and they went off the deep end. I've got God within me. God has given me special knowledge, special revelation. The Lord speaks to me. And so what happened in the early part of the church is you had two kinds of Christians. You had kind of the riffraff baptized, and they were just okay. And then you had the special, the elite Thomas Christians who had this special linkage with God. In fact, there was even a special ceremony that the Thomas Christians went through because they had this special standing, if you will, with God. Well, the leader of the church, the Pope, had a problem. The problem was he had two classes of Christians. They had the baptized, and then you had the Thomas Christians. And of course, the Pope thought that the Pope knew everything about
God.
Right. So the Thomas Christians are something of a threat to the Pope. And the Pope has got two classes of Christians. This is a problem. So what the Pope decided to do was, this is when the Bible was being formed. They were deciding what books would be in the Bible and what books they were going to throw out. And the debate was, do we include the Gospel of Thomas or do we include the Gospel of John? Now let's look at the Gospel of John for a moment. We have Matthew, Mark, and Luke. They're basically the same, and they stress kind of the humanity of Jesus. But then we get the Gospel of John. The Gospel of John is all about Jesus being God. We don't get that from Matthew, Mark, and Luke. You know how the Gospel of John begins? In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God, and then the Word dwelt among us full of grace and truth. Jesus was
God.
This is called high Christology. Christology is a study of Christ. This is high Christology. Jesus is God. Matthew, Mark, and Luke are low Christology. Jesus is human being. John talks about Jesus being God. Do you remember how God revealed God's self to Moses? Moses was being called by God. He was going to lead the people of Israel to freedom. They were captive in Egypt. And Moses is fighting with God about this. And then Moses says, well, who are you to ask me to do this? And God says,
I am who I am.
I am who I am. Ooh. Ooh. In the Gospel of John, Jesus says, I am the good shepherd. I am the gate for the sheep. I am the vine, you are the branches. I am the resurrection and the life. I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am the light of the world. Jesus says, I am. Jesus is fleshing out, if you will, what God said to Moses. Jesus must be God. Wow. Right. So if you want the holy, according to John, where do you look?
Jesus.
You look at Jesus. Because Jesus is
God.
What did Thomas write? If you want the holy, look
within.
What does John write? You want the holy, look at Jesus. Now, what's really interesting, if you look at the Gospel of John, Jesus doesn't teach people how to pray. Remember the disciples said to Jesus, how do we pray? That comes out of Matthew, Mark, and Luke. And what does Jesus teach them? He teaches them the Lord's Prayer. There's no Lord's Prayer in John. You want the holy? Look at
Jesus.
Forget about prayer. Gospel of John. There are no parables in the Gospel of John. How do I look at life? Remember the story of the Good Samaritan? You get that in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, all the parables. The Gospel of John. How do I look at life? Don't worry. If you want the holy, look at
Jesus.
So, the Pope has got an issue on his hands. So what does the Pope do? Gospel of Thomas, Jesus says, look within yourself. It's creating all these problems. Get rid of the Gospel of Thomas so it gets destroyed. Instead, we're going to focus on the Gospel of John. If you want the holy, look at Jesus. And that makes everybody the same, doesn't it? Now, the really interesting thing is when you read the Gospel of John, think about the way in which John depicts Thomas. Remember John, it's chapter 14, we read this in memorial services. Jesus said, I am going to prepare a place for you in my Father's house. In my Father's house is a great mansion. There are many rooms. I'm going to prepare a place for you that where I am, you may be also. And you know the way where I am going. Who doesn't get it?
Thomas.
Who's the big dummy? Thomas. When Jesus appears, he appears to the disciples and they're blessed. Receive the Holy Spirit. Who's not there?
Thomas.
And then when the disciples say, we've seen the Lord, who's the big doubter?
Thomas.
So how does John depict Thomas as the big
dummy?
The big dummy. The loser. Some people suggest the Gospel of John may have been written in response to Thomas. So what happens is the Pope decides we're going to go with John. We're going to get rid of Thomas. Thomas gets destroyed until the 1940s. And in the 1940s, there was some kind of farmer or something went into one of those caves in the Middle East and found a big jar. And he put his hand in the jar, pulled out some papers, decided he was cold, burned some of the papers, believe it or not. The other papers he kept, and guess what? It was included in the other papers. The Gospel of Thomas, which was discovered in the 1940s. That's why this is recent scholarship. So it's very interesting when you look at these stories about Jesus and when you consider the Gospel of Thomas. Now, the problem with the Gospel of Thomas is that Thomas Christians really took it to a bizarre extreme. in terms of having special knowledge and special revelation about God and all the rest of it, and therefore that created a problem. But recognize that the Gospel of Thomas does deal with a central truth. If you want to discover the holy, look within yourself, because you will find there the presence of God's Spirit. That is in concert with our understanding of baptism and communion. And throughout history, I would suggest to you that one of our struggles has been that we always emphasize God as being beyond us and being other. What was that song? Bette Midler sang it. What was the song by Bette Midler?
From a distance.
From a distance. God is watching you. Remember that? God is out there in a distance. God is watching. We don't emphasize the way we might have the presence and the power of God within you and within me. We just don't emphasize that. God is distant and an other. But that's what Thomas is focusing on. That can lead to issues for people. I remember a woman called me up once. She said, God spoke to me. God has given me a special revelation. I said, what is that? God wants our church to buy this golf course. I thought, boy, it's going to be a great day. I can tell already. I said, I don't think so. She said, why not? I said, because if God, that's God's golf course, we're all going to get holes in one every shot, and it'll be boring after a while. Well, church won't do very well then, so that's not going to work. Obviously, it can lead to issues for people. But there's something here that I think I hope we could take from, and that is that we have third day life. Third day life is the recognition that I have within me the power of God's Spirit. Thomas's doubting, in one sense, can be likened to my sense of I can't do it. I have to settle. Third day living is the recognition I can do it. I have potential. Because I can turn to the presence of God's Spirit within me. Third day living is an acceptance and an acknowledgement that I have that potential and I have that possibility before me, because I have the power of Christ within me. And one of the great tragedies of life, in my opinion, is the degree to which we live in that world of doubt. And we dismiss what could be possible for us. We settle for less than what life could be. Can we recognize it's just not me, but it's the power of Christ within me? Can I live into that third day life instead of settling? I'm not going to settle. Jesus came that I could have abundant life. That's third day living. I don't want to settle for day one and day two. I have possibility in front of me, and I can't get there on my own. But I know that if I can maintain that awareness that God is with me, that God is my strength, I can live into that new life. That's what being a Christian is all about. I've got the presence of God within me. I can get there. Not on my own, but with God's help. Don't doubt. Understand that that is before us. Thank you for your attention. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
We're going to sing. I invite you to stand if you're so moved.
Oh,
Let us affirm our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us pray.
O Lord, we are grateful for last week's service and all the people who assisted. Inspire us in this Easter season that we be people of the third day. Open our eyes to the beauty of this moment, and open our wills that we live into the abundance that is there for each of us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Holy Lord, new life breaks out all around us. May we savor the goodness that abounds. May your people be people of encouragement. Move us to reach out to others and give them a boost along the way. Make us ever aware of our own needs for support, that we ask for what we need. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Bless our church, O Lord, as we seek to open the hearts and minds of people to an awareness of your presence with us all. May we be vessels through which your Spirit touches the lives of those around us. Lord, in your goodness,
hear our prayer.
Lord, we are burdened for the people of the Ukraine and the horrors they experience. We pray that the leaders of the nations act to bring this bloodshed to an end. Bring peace, O Lord. Bring peace. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Lord, we are aware of so many who live in times of illness and distress. We pray that you would shepherd the hills and the Garbies in this period of mourning. We pray for Jeanette and Glenn living with cancer. We remember Annie at the Bradley Nursing Home. We pray for Aunt Anderson, who is ill with COVID, and we remember her family and friends. We ask, O Lord, that you would be the strength of Pastor Wilburn. And we lift up to you those we name in our hearts in the silence. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend ourselves, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your presence through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. God's peace be with you all.
And also with you.
You may nod to one another to share the God's peace. We don't pass an offering plate because of the COVID issues, but if you have a financial offering to share with the church, we are very grateful, and that can be left in the offering plate on the back of the center aisle. No matter who you are in your walk of faith, you are invited to receive the presence of Christ and the elements of Holy Communion at our church. If you would prefer to receive communion in the pew, please come forward and take the elements from the center table at the top of the aisle, and then return to your pew. I will then lead us all in receiving the elements. Afterwards, those who would prefer to receive communion at the altar are invited to come forward and kneel at the altar. Our choir is going to sing. You may be seated while our choir sings. Holy Lord, we return to you a symbol of our gratitude, what you have provided for us, ourselves, our time, and our possessions. Receive them, O Lord, for the sake of Jesus, who shows us the power and possibility which you bring to us and to all. Amen. The night he was betrayed, Jesus took bread and gave thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup and gave thanks, and he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood shed for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering the words Jesus taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed
be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Please stand if you are able. May the body and the blood of our risen Lord strengthen us and keep us in God's grace.
Amen.
Amen. May we have confidence that the Lord is before us and will meet us in all of our tomorrows. May we have the assurance that the Lord is beneath us to be our strength to carry us forward. May we have the trust that God is behind us, where the light of Christ dispels the shadows, that we be set free. May we have the assurance that God is above us, where Jesus has prepared a place for us in God's heaven. And may we live with the awareness that God is with us, that we may be people who live into the third day. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
We are going to sing our concluding hymn, and we will sing the first, the second, and the fifth verses. First, second, and fifth verses.
Christ is the Lord, the Lord is the Savior.
We live in the third day, serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I'm going to go to the hospital.